Talking about how COVID-19 has evolved over the last few years and how it is right now in 2021. About a year and a half ago, when the pandemic first began, I remember one of the fellows I worked with said everything is going to blow off in a couple of months and things will get back to normal. But here we are in 2021 in the middle of it and things are still going on. Now it feels like COVID is going to be part of our daily existence and how we approach this and manage this is something that we're all getting educated on, and right now on a Monday evening back in India. So I'll continue to proceed. So just a brief disclaimer that the contents of this presentation don't represent Mayo Clinic Institute's policies or any recommendations. No conflict of interest, and all the information here is current as of June 27th. And the way things are changing, so many things change within just 24 hours with respect to COVID. So the objectives of my talk specifically is to look at the epidemiology right now of COVID virus, and as well as focusing on prevention and how to really tackle the ongoing pandemic. And there's so much that we can talk about. So what I wanted to focus on really was outpatient evaluation and management of COVID-19 in adults. The reason being that I feel that all of us get approached by family members, relatives, and especially relatives of pediatric patients with so many questions about testing, how they should approach situations if they test positive, and how to look at mild infections, which can be managed as an outpatient. And there are a lot of fears about complications and also fears and concerns about different therapies and questions about evolving therapies as well. So that's what I'll be focusing on in today's talk. So first, the epidemiology of COVID-19. So the spread of COVID-19 has been pretty alarming over the last few months. And though all of us have been restricted on travel, the virus has certainly traveled all over the world. And here's a picture showing how it's boomed across every continent in the world. The first case, as everyone is aware, was detected in Wuhan, China. And the first case in the US was in Washington State, just a month later, January 2020. And this was detected in a traveler, in an individual who traveled to Wuhan. And the first case in India was detected in Kerala, once again, in a student who was returning from Wuhan. So definitely, at that time, it was all traceable spread from one location to the other. And after 1.5 years, right now, this is the graph showing daily cases across the world. So a total of 180 million cases or 18 crore cases that have been detected so far, with a large number of deaths as well, which has devastated so people socially, politically, economically across the world. So a huge, huge burden of disease, and it's definitely a public health crisis. Cases in the US, this is a graph that represents that, where we can see distinct waves of disease, where the first one was between June to August of last year, a pretty small wave, and then the larger wave that we noticed between October till February. Right now, fortunately, cases have tapered off, and it's been pretty stable over the last few months. Some of it attributed to vaccinations, a lot of it also just to social distancing measures and lockdowns that have been instituted across different states. And here's a similar graph looking at how cases have progressed in India. And similar to how there was a first wave and a second wave globally and in the US, there was a first wave between August through December. Things looked like it was getting much better. And then we had the unfortunate second wave, which everyone is painfully familiar with, just because of how it has been devastating different cities, hospital systems, and led to many, many infections and many more deaths than what was anticipated. It's fortunate to see that the cases have been dropping off. The hope is that this stays the same. Part of the reason for the ongoing pandemic is thought to be from COVID-19 variants. And these variants are named according to the Greek alphabet, alpha, beta, gamma, and delta. And they're named after the locations where they've been identified in different locations across the world to avoid naming them based off of the location. So this is the system that's been developed. So alpha is the one was detected in the UK, beta is from South Africa, and gamma is from Brazil, and the delta variant, as we know, was detected in India. There are different terminologies for how these are referred to, and I'm just going to go over these because these come up in the news quite a lot. So variant of interest is just any genetic variant that's been identified, which different healthcare agencies are keeping a close eye on. Variant of concern is any genetic variant which is concerning for either evading current immune system, current immunity of people, where vaccines may or may not be effective going forward, and also where there's been resistance shown to monoclonal antibody therapy. Finally, we have something called variant of consequence, which fortunately none of the current genetic variants fall under this. And this refers to instances where previously infected people's immunity or vaccines would completely not be able to cover the variant. And this is something which we really want to prevent. And the measures we're taking to prevent that is by genetic surveillance instituted by viral institutes across the world to keep a close eye on variants of concern to try and curb their spread. So from Delta, there's a new variant, Delta Plus, which has been identified in India within the last 1 month, and it has spread to 12 other countries as well. So something that we're keeping a close eye on. Preliminary reports have shown that this spreads pretty rapidly, but the mortality may not be higher than any of the previous variants. So just a few words about the Delta variant, because it's thought that this is the one that has driven the pandemic to the current proportions in India. So 90% of cases during the second wave in India are from the Delta variant. 20% of cases currently in the US have been attributed to the Delta variant. And this is fueling the third wave in the UK. It is highly transmissible, and there's concern for resistance to several of the existing monoclonal antibody therapies. But fortunately, vaccines still seem to be providing protection against this variant. So I mentioned the third wave briefly. So questions about the third wave. Is India going to have a third wave? Is the world going to see a third wave? And this is a graph from UK showing the beginning of a third wave. So that's something which is very concerning, because it looked, they had a similar second peak, like how India did and how the US did, seemed to taper off exactly how it did in both of our countries. And now it is rising again. So it is very likely that we're going to see a third wave in India. So this is something that we need to anticipate. And there have been predictions that this is likely to occur around August through October. And the reasons being that there is a very large unvaccinated population in India. Only 4% of the population have been fully vaccinated, and 19% have received one dose. One thing that was really really nice to hear, especially within the last 24 hours, is to find out that the number of people who have been vaccinated in India has surpassed the US as well, which shows that it's been the public health efforts to ramp up vaccinations are working. So there's hope that we can accelerate the process over the next few months, but it would still be difficult to say that a large enough population would be vaccinated to prevent a third wave. And also prolonged lockdown and social measures, public health measures, are just challenging in a country that is so diverse and populated as India. So how do we go about dampening the third wave? What we really need to do is, looking at the first and the second waves that we've had, we really need to focus on measures that will allow us to bring a wave where we saw close to 4 lakh cases in a day, going from that to what we had initially, where we had less than 1 lakh cases in a day. If we can bring this, we would be able to prevent overwhelming the medical system and hopefully curbing complications from the illness, as well as preventing deaths, which was the unfortunate situation in the second wave. So how do we go about preventing COVID-19? And the reason I touch on this first is because this is something which we really need to focus on so that we don't have a similar situation arise again. So talking about vaccines, there are 3 main types of vaccines that are currently available all across the world. And the principles of these is pretty straightforward. The main final goal is that we want our body to mount an immune system. And this is done against the spike protein of the coronavirus. So the first type of vaccine is a protein-based vaccine. These are the ones that we're really familiar with, where you take a protein, purify it. It's an inactivated protein. There's no risk for infection from this. Injected into the body, mounts an immune system. The second type is where we use a viral vector, where the genetic material that codes for the spike protein is inserted into an innocuous virus. Here it's an adenovirus in the vaccines that we have. This viral vector is injected into the body. The genetic material present within the adenovirus uses the host cell's machinery to produce the protein, and this mounts the immune system response. And then we've got these novel vaccines, the mRNA vaccine, which is something that we all heard about only when talking about the COVID vaccines, is where the mRNA itself is inserted into the body, and the mRNA is then translated into the protein, and then the same immune system reaction is produced. And one thing that has been really inspiring is how rapidly the healthcare system, the medical fraternity, has been able to come up with vaccines that have been made available to the population. And that's something which was unexpected last year. But the fact that we've been able to get effective vaccines is something which is definitely providing hope to us when we're trying to fight against the pandemic. So what are the vaccines that are available right now? Just looking at the vaccines in India and in the US. So in India right now, we've got the Covaxin, which is the indigenously produced vaccine by Bharat Biotech. Then there's Covishield, which is the AstraZeneca vaccine. Sputnik V was just recently approved in May. And then in the US, we've got the Pfizer vaccine and the Moderna vaccine, as well as the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, which was briefly halted, but was renewed again in April. The classification of these vaccines, and that's why I've arranged them separately like this. The Covaxin is a purified protein vaccine. The Pfizer and Moderna are mRNA vaccines, and the remainder are all viral vector vaccines. One interesting thing is that the Sputnik V vaccine actually has the first and the second dose have two different genetic materials, the thought being that by producing different components of the spike protein, a more robust immune response could be mounted. So next question of who is eligible for the vaccine? So as of now in India, everyone over the age of 18 has now been approved to get the vaccine. In the US, as Dr. Sophia had mentioned, the Pfizer vaccine has been approved for children over the age of 12. Pregnant and lactating women can receive the vaccine. It's just that caution has to be utilized while determining if it is completely safe in them. So the current guidelines say clinical judgment is to be taken into account when providing vaccines to pregnant and lactating women. There have been some studies that showed that when pregnant women received the vaccine, antibodies were passed on to their infants and this was detected after their birth. So there is benefit there as well to give some passive immunity to children who are born to women who are vaccinated. People who have had prior COVID-19 infections can also get the vaccine. The only recommendation is to wait about 2 weeks after symptoms resolve, and in case they've received a monoclonal antibody, to wait 90 days. Immunocompromised individuals can also receive the vaccine. This is something which I feel a lot of us think that, oh, we shouldn't give a vaccine to them, but we need to bear in mind that none of the vaccines are live vaccines. They're not vaccines that have been genetically modified from the original virus itself. All of these are inactivated protein products or genetic material which cannot actually cause the infection. The only thing to bear in mind is that these people have a tendency to mount a poorer immune response. So even if they're vaccinated, they can't lower their guard down with regard to their susceptibility to infection. The contraindications, the strictest contraindications really is if they have an immediate allergic reaction, and over here we mean an anaphylactic reaction. If they have a known allergy to vaccine components, that's another reason to avoid that particular vaccine, although sometimes they can receive an alternate vaccine if this is what has been identified. So what are the benefits of getting the vaccine? Overall, all the vaccines together, I was looking at the data, there's 60 to 80% efficacy against getting the illness. The mRNA vaccines offer about 90 to 95% efficacy. The ones present in India, Covaxin, Covishield, are within the 60 to 80% range. there is reduced severity of illness that's been noticed after getting the vaccine and reduction in hospitalization. And but through both of these is reduction in mortality as well. And getting the vaccine reduces transmission and decreases viral shedding of the vaccine from infected individuals. So overall, what do we do with this knowledge? So when there is a family that is coming to you, children aren't eligible for vaccines right now in India. But by vaccinating the adult population, parents and grandparents, is how we can protect the children. So that's why encouraging individuals to get vaccines is so important, to try and protect those where we are unable to vaccinate right now. What are the adverse events from vaccines? And this is something which has definitely caused a lot of discussion among the public about whether or not to get the vaccine itself. And the major adverse event which has come to our attention is something called thrombosis with thrombocytopenia syndrome. It's a new condition which has been described specifically for, in relation to the clots that have been seen with certain vaccines. The two where we have had the most reports are the AstraZeneca vaccine or the Covishield, and then the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. And that was one of the reasons why the administration of the vaccine was halted in the US. And the symptoms that could occur from these involve venous thrombosis or mesenteric clots. So they present with headaches, abdominal pain, and the incidence is usually within 4 to 20 days of receiving the vaccine. Could be just one dose, could be two doses as well, after the second dose as well. And with Johnson & Johnson, is just a single dose vaccine. So within 4 to 20 days of getting the first dose. The tests that are recommended is getting platelet counts, imaging to look for the clots, and the management is generally non-heparin anticoagulation. For the most part, the incidence has been pretty low and people have recovered from these adverse events. So that's why the recommendation is still to proceed with vaccination while keeping caution for these for these side effects. Other side effects that have cropped up are myocarditis and pericarditis in adults who have received the mRNA vaccine. And this is under a lot of study, and I'm aware that the cardiology department is looking at a case series as well. So we'll have more data about this in due course of time. So next, looking at transmission and how to prevent the spread of the virus. So this is an animated image over here looking at how droplets and aerosols are spreading from an individual after a violent cough. And the distance that we see over here is about a meter. And you can see how without any masking, without any protection, these droplets can spread completely through that 1 meter within a few seconds and also beyond that. So within 3 to 6 feet is usually the range at which a person can inhale droplets and aerosol from an infected individual. Deposition on exposed mucous membranes is another way in which it's transmitted. And another thing to bear in mind is staying in an enclosed space or exposure for greater than 15 minutes to somebody who is sick, regardless of where you are, can increase your risk of getting the infection. So how do we go about preventing the transmission? So the main things which has been discussed quite frequently in the media, as well as what we've received education about, is to wash hands, sanitize hands, socially distance, and the minimum being 6 feet, and also wearing face masks. All of these put together can bring down the transmission by 60 to 80% through different studies that have been done around the world. And this really forms the backbone of preventing transmission and also the backbone of preventing the next wave of the pandemic. We have a lot of new medications and therapies, but really this is where the public health focus should be on. So perhaps in around the world, instead of having functions and marriages that look like this, we should be transitioning to something more like this on Zoom. And I saw this humorous post on social media as well, which is recommending against going on holidays, saying that those of you going on holiday before the third wave arrives, you are likely to contribute to the third wave. So just being cognizant and vigilant about our actions on a day-to-day basis can really help with preventing a third wave from really devastating the healthcare system like how the previous ones have. So now I'm going to talk briefly about how to manage COVID-19 in the outpatient setting. So really focusing on mild infections in adults. And the first thing that I wanted to talk about was the different tests that are available. So there are three different tests available for COVID. The first one is a nucleic acid test, which is the PCR test to detect the mRNA virus. And then the second test is the antigen test, which detects viral proteins. And the third one is the serologic test, which detects patient antibodies in blood sample. The first two are done using nasal or oral swab to get a sample where we perform the test on. The serologic test is used to detect past infection or response to vaccines. And the antigen test has the advantage of being really rapid, but also we need to bear in mind that it's not as sensitive as the nucleic acid test, so there's a high risk of false negatives. So really the gold standard for diagnosis is the nucleic acid testing. So who do we test and how do we go about testing individuals? Anyone with symptoms should be tested. And the reason being that when there is a global pandemic, the pre-test probability of an infection is really high. And as we have seen, pretty much any symptom can, at this point of time, could really be from COVID. The picture here shows all the common symptoms that we're aware of with the respiratory illness, and specifically with COVID, the anosmia, which has been noted in individuals, but really not more than 40 to 60% of people, according to different studies, have really shown anosmia. So we can't say that that's a specific finding either. People can also have chest pain, abdominal pain, diarrhea. Sometimes it's really just some mental fogginess, which could be the reason, which could be a manifestation of COVID. So if there is a suspicion for COVID, the test should be done. But we also need to bear in mind that even with the most sensitive testing, something that's 99% sensitive, you can still have false negatives. And here's a graph showing testing characteristics of of most of the COVID tests that we have, the PCR testing. They're all in the range of 90 to 95, some of them 99% sensitive. But even when there is somebody who has a very high pre-test probability of having the infection, if they do have a negative test, say they're 80% chance of having the infection, if they have a negative test, the chance of having the infection is still pretty high and above the threshold of diagnosis. So if a person presents where their disease is acting like COVID, if it's talking, walking like COVID, then that's something that is COVID, and they should be managed as COVID is to be managed. But that being said, we also need to ensure that we don't forget to consider alternate diagnosis, especially with social distancing and decreasing contact with patients. There's a loss in how we do our general history taking and physical examination. And oftentimes a lot of other conditions do get missed. And I specifically bring this up because just anecdotally over the last few months, there have been several young people who have been tested multiple times for COVID for a prolonged cough, but just because they met different practitioners every time, diagnosis of a mediastinal mass, a lymphoma got missed in some of these people. So it's still important to be able to use our clinical judgment when we're diagnosing COVID patients. So how do we triage COVID once a patient has been diagnosed? So the first thing to really think about is if they're not too sick, and I can go over the different criteria there, but if they're not too sick, to have them stay at home, to wear a mask, to isolate themselves. Everyone's got a cell phone these days, so it really is important to maximize the utilization of these resources to protect the individual, their relatives, their neighbors, as well as us as physicians who are here to take care of these patients. And we really need to protect ourselves as well when we're trying to give the best care that we can. But this does give us a way to monitor them and also triage them appropriately. And the only real technology that or other resource that that would be useful here is a pulse oximeter. And these are some things which are available pretty easily now because of the increased manufacturing. Of course, the prices can vary quite a bit. But what we've been doing in several of the health systems here is to have a package which includes a pulse oximeter, blood pressure cuff, and also small tablets where the patient can record their symptoms, record their oxygen saturation, and also touch base with a healthcare provider every day just to make sure that things are going on okay and their their symptoms still stay in the mild range and detect early on when somebody would need a higher level of care. So these are the different categories and criteria where we would think of a higher level of care. So with regard to symptoms, if someone's having shortness of breath that's disabling, and the way in which this can be checked when someone is just talking on the phone is if they have an inability to speak in full sentences. Respiratory rate greater than or equal to 24 breaths per minute. This is also a sign of distress. And oxygen saturation less than 94% on room air at any time, whether they're at rest or whether they're moving around. And how we can assess their tolerance to activity is with the 6-minute walk test, which a person can do in the confines of their home within a single room where they're isolating. And during this 6-minute walk test, if there is a fall in oxygen saturation less than 94%, or if there's a fall of 3 to 5% from the baseline where they start, so say they're at 99% at rest, but with the 6-minute walk test, they drop to 95%, that's still very concerning. And if they develop lightheadedness or worsening dyspnea when they're trying to walk. So these are to be monitored on a daily basis. And if any of these are positive, this would be classified as moderate to severe COVID, and the patient needs to be seen by a healthcare provider and best seen at a hospital with facilities to take care of COVID patients. If it's detected that they need to get admitted, they can get inpatient care expediently. So how do we go about managing mild COVID? So first of all, trying to stay isolated, protect people who are in the house with them, wear a mask, wash hands, sanitize. Symptom management is pretty much like any flu-like illness. So providing antipyretics, paracetamol, making sure there is adequate rest, hydration, nutrition is being maintained. And the recommendations for quarantining at home is at least 10 days from symptom onset, not the testing, but the symptom being found to be present. And at least 24 hours without any fever or chills. And the reasoning behind this is that several studies have shown that viral shedding decreases by day 9 to 8 of being diagnosed. And monitoring for worsening clinical status is very important to see, note that the critical period of deterioration tends to be between days 7 to 10, which is when respiratory distress has been noted to be setting in. And again, reiterating on social distancing, washing hands, and wearing a mask. Next, I wanted to talk briefly about the role of imaging in diagnosis of COVID-19. And it does seem that almost everybody seems to get a CT scan because there were initial reports saying that CT can be used for diagnosis. But really the recommendations, and these are guidelines that have looked at from Ministry of Health and Family Welfare, as well as the NIH guidelines, which state that really only moderate to severe cases should get a CT scan. And these are also done only when there's clinical deterioration, despite recommended inpatient therapy, when the patient's on oxygen, and also after they've received things like remdesivir and steroids. And the reason this is usually being done is to look for invasive fungal infection. Clinical judgment of a specialist is definitely something to take into account when certain instances like suspicion for a pulmonary embolism would be another indication to get a CT, except with an angiogram to rule out clots when if somebody were to become more hypoxic than what is expected. And the reason why we would like to limit CT scans and some of these which I will enumerate now is that findings are noted in 2/3 of people who are asymptomatic. And the imaging findings are the ones that you see here on the corner of the screen where there are diffuse bilateral ground glass opacities. And these can be present throughout the lungs. And in the lower half of the image, you see how they've progressed with some extra edema as well. And you can see an ARDS picture, even or something similar to that with patchy infiltrates, even early on in the infection in people who are asymptomatic, where there's no progression of the disease, they may recover. And finding this information can just cause unnecessary anxiety, hospitalization, where the benefit of it really is not outweighing the risks of the CT itself. Early CTs may actually be falsely reassuring. So again, getting it early on, having a negative CT could make somebody feel like they're not at high risk for a severe disease. So if they do develop shortness of breath, say on day 7 or 8 of their illness, they may feel that things are not that bad because their CT was okay. And similarly, physicians may also feel falsely reassured. There's also a variable correlation between the amount of lung involvement and the level of hypoxia, which is noted. This correlation is mostly discordant because of different age groups. So younger individuals have a robust immune system. They may have more lung findings, but they're not as hypoxic, not as sick, and they recover much better. Whereas older individuals may not have as many findings on the lung, but they do become pretty hypoxic and they can have complications from it. So having an arbitrary cutoff of a certain percentage of lung being involved, being a reason for admission, may miss a lot of people who are actually much sicker. So really we should be going by the level of hypoxia and oxygen saturation when triaging individuals. Several of these lesions persist during recovery as well. And of course, there's a radiation risk from CT. So outpatient therapy, and I'm starting with what not to do because there's just so many studies, so many things in the media looking at several different therapies. And a lot of therapies which have been approved for inpatient use, which there's always a question of how do we use this in the outpatient setting and if they should be used at all. So the first one being remdesivir. So this is an antiviral agent, which is only indicated if a person is hospitalized, if they're on oxygen, and it should be given within 10 days of symptom onset. Now, it is true that there are a lot of people who are being managed with oxygen at home. So those could be exceptions where remdesivir could be considered. And this is given as an IV infusion. So you do need a facility where you can provide the medication as well. Tocilizumab is an anti-IL-6 antibody. It has been used in rheumatoid arthritis as an immunomodulator, and it gained a lot of popularity in initial stages in critically ill patients with COVID. And really the indication is only in critically ill patients where there's no improvement with oxygen. And when the patient is noted to have high inflammatory markers like high CRP and also IL-6s as well as tested. And there is some mortality benefit from giving this, but not in anyone in the outpatient setting. Steroids, as Dr. Sophia had also mentioned before, there is mortality benefit in people who are on oxygen, but there are so many risk factors associated with steroids to keep in mind. It is harmful in mild cases. It prolongs viral shedding, so it increases transmission risk. And it also leads to immunosuppression in patients who may otherwise have been doing okay with fighting the virus themselves. And as everyone is aware of, steroids do cause alteration in blood glucose levels as well. And this has been thought to be driving the associated epidemic in India of mucormycosis as well, which has been causing a lot of mortality. So it's important to bear in mind and limit the use of steroids. Anticoagulation, again, not indicated in the outpatient setting. It's only for moderate to severe disease. And when someone is hospitalized, there are a lot of recommendations to triage individuals based on the D-dimer level to figure out whom to anticoagulate. And also a final word on antibiotics, ivermectin, hydroxychloroquine. These are all things which have popped up in the past with thoughts about some benefit. But none of the studies that have been done so far have shown any evidence of benefit in adults. On their own, if there is a reason for indication, antibiotics are definitely recommended if there's suspicion for a bacterial infection. But for the most part, when someone comes in with COVID, it usually is just isolated COVID, unless they're at risk or immunosuppressed and you're suspicious of an infection as well. So I wanted to talk about monoclonal antibodies and plasma. And here's an image showing how monoclonal antibodies are thought to be useful. So when we're able to inject an individual with antibodies that act against the spike protein, the idea is that this prevents the binding of the spike protein to the ACE receptors on the human cell. So thereby you can decrease the chances of infection itself in the individual. The indications for these are in high-risk individuals, and there is an emergency use authorization which has been approved in the US as well as in India, and determining explaining who these individuals are. So anyone who's obese with a BMI over the age of 35, age over 65 years, someone with chronic kidney disease, with diabetes type 1 and type 2, if they're immunocompromised, and also if they're over the age of 55 but have cardiovascular disease, hypertension, COPD. This does end up capturing quite a large population in around the world. So there are a lot of people who could benefit from these monoclonal antibodies. In children, there is not as much data, but over the age of 12, among these categories, it is considered, it can be considered children with BMI over the 85th percentile for their age and gender, sickle cell disease, if they have a heart disease, neurodevelopmental disorder, or if they have asthma or reactive airway disease. This is something that can be considered in a monitored setting. A lot of the time, it's encouraged that people who are getting these enroll in a trial so that we can get more data about these treatments. These are not indicated in people who are these are only indicated in people who are not hospitalized. And if they're hospitalized, it should be for something other than COVID itself, without any additional oxygen requirement. So what are the antibodies that are available right now to us? Most of these are an alphabet soup, really. It's difficult to really say all of these names. But the earliest one that was approved was bamlanivimab and etesevimab, marketed in India by Eli Lilly. And then the second one is kesarivimab and imdevimab, which is marketed in India by Roche. And there's a trial in UK as well where it's called REGEN-COV2. And then the third one is sotrovimab, which is the newest one, which is not available in India at the moment. All of these are given as single IV infusions, but subcutaneous administration is also permitted. They're to be given within 10 days of symptom onset. And it's okay to use if someone has been previously vaccinated. It's also okay to use in pregnancy and lactation if they have one of the indications mentioned previously. And it can be used in children as well if it's indicated. One thing to bear in mind is if someone's received these antibiotics, it's important to wait 90 days before vaccinating them. Now, unfortunately, there is resistance to bamlanivimab that's developed across several of the new COVID variants. So, in fact, this is actually the bamlanivimab has now, it's not permitted to be used in the US anymore because of risk of resistance and how it may not be helpful to even give it in patients. So that really leaves us with the second combination of monoclonal antibodies. And I wanted to quickly summarize some of the data we have from clinical trials. Things to bear in mind is that only two are in phase three trials right now, and peer review is not complete for any of these. There's no published data that we have, but the preliminary results show that there's a 2 to 5% absolute risk reduction in hospitalization or death through the first 28 days after getting these antibodies, and there is a 70% relative risk reduction. And how this data is really received is that the trial that looked at the REGEN-COV2 showed that 1.3% of individuals in the trial population had a reduction in hospitalization or death, and this was taken as a composite outcome, versus 4.6% incidence in those receiving the placebo. So doing some quick mathematics there, it shows that the number needed to treat is 30, which means that 30 people have to get this monoclonal antibody, and 30%, and this will be 30 people in the high-risk group should get this before one person shows benefit. So difficult to really say if how feasible this would be or how useful this would be. And there are side effects of anaphylaxis and infusion reactions. So I would say slightly ambiguous about how excited we should be about monoclonal antibodies, but it is something definitely to bear in mind as an option to treat people with mild infection. A brief word about recovery from mild COVID-19. The fortunate thing to bear in mind is that 80% of cases tend to have mild COVID-19, and most of them recover completely. Viral shedding diminishes within 10 days, so they can stop quarantine after 10 days. But things which are currently evolving is that there is a concern for something called a post-COVID-19 syndrome or a long hauler syndrome. And this is a combination of symptoms which include fatigue, brain fog, just a feeling of listlessness, which seems to be persisting for several months after recovery from COVID. And right now, there are several specialists in general internal medicine who are setting up a clinic to try and assess these patients and provide therapy for them. And a lot of the management is really geared towards managing the symptoms of fatigue. And the approach to it is very similar to management of fibromyalgia. So it's really a systemic approach with conservative management, no specific medication so far, but just physical therapy as well as psychotherapy sometimes to help with coping with these symptoms. There have been several studies, case reports that show there's been damage to the heart, lungs, the brain, and there can be prolonged recovery from these, especially with more complicated illnesses. But sometimes even with mild illnesses, several months down the line, somebody might have myocarditis or have demonstration of an increased susceptibility to small insults to the lung. And these are things which are still evolving. So really only time will tell how people do after recovery. As we all know, we only have data from about 1.5 years right now. So over the years, we'll find out more information. So to summarize quickly about what was just discussed and just going over things and from questions that we could get asked by our patients as well as their relatives. Is COVID-19 coming to an end? Not really in the foreseeable future. We need to accept that this is something that's going to stay with us for the next months to years, and we need to be prepared for a third wave as well, mostly driven by COVID-19 variants. When should we test individuals, really, if there's any suspicion of infection or exposure? And we also need to be wary of false negatives and be cognizant that if someone looks like they have COVID, they should get the management that they need. Who should be vaccinated? Everyone over 18 years of age, and quite literally anyone who becomes eligible. So when it opens up to younger individuals, they should be vaccinated as well. How do we prevent transmission? Again, reiterating hand washing, social distancing, as well as wearing masks. Outpatient management of COVID-19, mostly conservative management, supportive care, using telehealth and amassing resources that are available right now in this day and age to prevent exposure and protect healthcare workers as well, where we can effectively monitor, triage them so that we can give care and optimize care to people who need it the most, and avoiding treatments with limited benefit. And finally, on monoclonal antibodies, there is benefit in people with high risk, but there's also concern for resistance. So that's something to keep in mind. So these are the references that I used while preparing these slides. And topics for further discussion are inpatient management of COVID-19, insulin resistance during and after COVID-19, which is something that was brought up in the previous discussion as well. And also more information on the post-COVID-19 syndrome, because after so many people who have been infected, this is something which is probably going to be the next thing that we will have to tackle in the years to come. And so finally, I wanted to conclude by expressing my gratitude for being given this opportunity to speak to everybody here. This has been really educational for me, going over the current literature and current information that we have. And I think one thing to bear in mind is that it would be really nice if we had a quick fix for this problem, but none of us are really heroes in this situation, but we can do our small bit by educating ourselves as well as carrying out public health measures to prevent the spread of COVID. So thank you, everybody, and hoping that everybody has a good evening and good night.